So I've labeled my sermon this week, the kind of faith that saves. The kind of faith that saves. Before I go into the detail, let's unpack this word faith. You know, faith, I think Pastor Elvin touched on this a little bit last week, is we have faith in someone. We can also say we have faith in something. We can also say that we have faith in a theory. Or you can say, I believe in a theory. I believe in so-and-so. I believe in something. And in fact, we exercise faith every day. One of the biggest things that we're called to exercise in this time around the world is faith in the vaccine. Everyone have to decide, do you have faith in the vaccine you're taking to prevent to not have any side effect and to help prevent you from catching COVID-19? That is exercising faith. Faith in the vaccine. Believe in the vaccine that will prevent you from doing this. Another way to think about this word faith is something that you can lean on. I have faith that, you know, I can lean on this person, I can trust this person. So with that in mind, I want us to unpack this concept of faith. Faith that saves. Now, as I shared just now, there are the faith that saves. There are also misplaced faith in something that wouldn't save us. And today's passage actually is Paul going through a bunch of misplaced faith that will not save us. And he also go through the type of faith that can save us. That is the juice of Romans 4. And you know, we all come from different backgrounds. We have different experiences. We grow up in different type of environment. When the Romans was written, it was written to the believers in Rome at that time. And part of those believers, there are Jewish believers, there are also Gentiles believers in there. So let me... Okay. Let's read the first verse. I can't see. My eyesight is... Abraham was, humanly speaking, the founder of our Jewish nation. What did he discover about being made right with God? So that was the starting question that started off the whole chapter. And based on that question, you can tell that the primary audience that Paul writing to on this verse 4, the whole letter is to the both Jews and Gentiles, but on Romans chapter 4, his primary audience is the Jews, right? It says, founder of our Jewish nation. And I also argue that whatever he's writing, he's not just addressing the Jews, but also some of the Gentile believers that have been with these Jewish believers long enough to catch some of the baggages that these Jews bring with them as they became believers from their Jewish tradition. Now, us here this morning, actually is quite similar to them. I look at my children and a lot of the young people here, they grew up in a Christian family. They grew up in a Christian environment. Some of them go to Christian schools. Some of them do Bible studies. Some of them even do youth group, children church. They grew up in a Christian environment. But some of us here are first generation believers, like me, like my wife. I grew up in as a so-called Gentile family. And entertainment for a second, if you grow up in a Christian environment, you are kind of like the Jews, right? So all of us come with a certain baggages that we carry. And Paul, when he, last week, he talked about how it's not by works, but by faith that someone gain righteousness. And let us just use a term that we're more used to, salvation, right? To the Jews, gain righteousness is equivalent to us today saying salvation. They understand that in the same way. So how do we gain salvation? Of course, by faith, right? We talk about that a lot. And but if I ask all of us here that has been attending church, I'm sure it's so easy for you to quote how you can be saved. And you quote the gospel, right? We're saved through faith, by grace, not by our own works, but what Jesus has done on the cross. We believe that the transaction that he entered in through Jesus going to the cross took away our sins, that we are deserving to be punished, and the punishment is death. He took that. He went. He died. He rose again. By him rising, he justified us. And we are now right before God. That's how we got our salvation. I'm sure we can all do that. But again, do we carry some of the similar baggages like the Jews, the Jewish believers, and the early Christian in Rome back then? Some of those baggages we can see so clearly, but some of them are subconscious. And today, as we go through the passage, I want us, as we talk about the baggages that the Jews were facing back then, that they carry with them as they became followers of Christ, I want us to reflect on ourselves, whether we have some of the baggages that we still carry with us that will hinder our relationship with God, that will add unnecessary burden on ourselves. Okay. Let's continue to read. If his good deeds had made him acceptable to God, he would have had something to boast about. But that was not God's way. For the scriptures tell us, Abraham believed God, and God counted him as righteous because of his faith. He's counted. Paul quoted Abraham, used Abraham as an example, as a witness to prove his point that salvation comes through faith alone. And he uses Abraham. And he uses Scripture. At that time, it's the Old Testament. And we will go through that later. Abraham, he quoted, Abraham believed God, and God counted him as righteous because of his faith. Nothing else. Because of his faith. When people work, their wages are not a gift, but something they have earned. So Paul then go on and say that God, the reason that God came out of this way of salvation is because he wants us to understand, and he wants us to not able to boast about our goodness, because our goodness is filthy rags to him. Doesn't match up to his standard of righteousness, not even close. Even Abraham, known for his obedience and his faith, is not sufficient to be made righteous. He's made righteous purely because he believed God. And because of this faith, he is made righteous. So if we were able to work ourselves into salvation, then that salvation is, we deserve it. It's like our pay, our paycheck. We put in certain hours, we get paid certain amount. But people are counted as righteous, counted, not because of their work, but because of their faith in God, who forgives sinner. David, now he quotes a second witness. So not just one, two. David also spoke of this when he described the happiness of those who are declared righteous without working for it. Oh, what a joy for those whose disobedience is forgiven, whose sins are put out of sight. Yes, what a joy for those who record the Lord has cleared of sin. I highlighted disobedience is forgiven. So if it's by work, that which means we have to obey God to gain salvation. How many of us have disobeyed God before? If the requirement is obedience for salvation, we will be hopeless. I think this is very straightforward, right? No one would disagree with this statement. In fact, it's clearly laid out. So we can say faith in obedience, or trusting in obedience, or believing in obedience for salvation is out of the question, right? Do we all agree on that? How about this? What about faith in faith? What about trusting in faith, in our faith? After all, Abraham is considered father of faith, right? Alvin shared last week how strong the faith of Abraham is, to the point where he's willing to obey God's command of sacrificing Isaac, all the way to the point of, is that the faith that saved Abraham, you think? How many of you have heard people say sometimes, we have to really believe for God to make that happen for you, for God to heal you, for God to do this for you? We really have to believe in faith. Actually, quite often, right? But I want us to remember in the context today. We're talking about salvation. When was Abraham deemed righteous? It was actually in chapter 15, verse 6. The right kind of faith that will save you is not faith in how strong our faith is. But the right kind of faith that saves us is the faith in the promise giver. Let me repeat that. Faith in the promise giver. And let us read this Genesis where Paul quoted. And let me show you why I believe that's the case. Genesis 15 happened when it's a conversation between God and Abraham. It happened shortly after Lot was captured and Abraham went and rescued Lot, right? And then when Lot came back, was rescued, Abraham met this person, this priest. I'm going to butcher the pronunciation, Melchizedek. Sorry, English my second language. Melchizedek, okay, something like that. And then it says, sometime later, the Lord spoke to Abraham. And at that time, he's still Abraham, not Abraham yet, in a vision, and said to him, do not be afraid, Abraham, for I will protect you, and your reward will be great. Let me ask you a question. Does God need to say that if Abraham is not afraid? God already said that I'm going to make you a great nation. I will be with you. Why do you think Abraham is afraid? Is that someone that showed great faith? Do you think? Let's read on. But Abraham replied, O sovereign Lord, what good are all your blessings when I don't even have a son? Is that someone that shows great faith that God is good, whatever God said is going to happen, that he's going to be a great nation? He has doubt, just like any one of us have doubt. And you know what? I can kind of relate to Abraham. When he was called and he left his home country, Lot, his nephew, followed, right? He viewed Lot and he groomed him. He poured in so much to Lot and he groomed Lot. I think in his mind, this nephew is like his son. He's probably thinking Lot is going to what God is going to use Lot to fulfill this promise of making him, you know, a great nation. But then Lot decided to part ways with Abraham. Even after he rescued Lot, we later on learn that Lot went back to Sodom. Right? He didn't stay with Abraham. So it's like losing a son. And Abraham is sitting there, and that's why he's actually a little bit venting, you know, like, since you have given me no children, you have given me no children. God, you have given me no children. Eliza of Damascus, a servant in my household, will inherit all my wealth. Since you, God, have not given me a son, the servant is going to inherit all my wealth. You have given me no descendants of my own, so one of my servants will be my heir. Is that someone that demonstrates great faith in God, you think? To me, I don't think so. But this is when he has doubt, when Abraham has doubt, who shows up? Every single time God shows up, the promise giver. So God then said to him, no, Abraham, your servant will not be your heir, for you will have a son of your own. Now he's telling Abraham very clearly, Abraham, it's not Lot, it's not this servant, you will have a son of your own. You, Abraham. Then the Lord took Abraham. It's not sufficient that God didn't leave it that way. He actually, in addition to saying, he actually took Abraham out and said to him, look up to the sky and count the stars if you can. Of course, he can. That's how many descendants you will have. And this is the verse that Paul quoted. And Abraham believed the Lord. So it's not like Abraham have strong faith, but Abraham just merely believed God when God tells him something. Before this, when he was called, God told him, move, follow me. I'll show you a place that I will give to you. He moved. He at the Canaan, God said, this is the land that I'll give you and your descendants. He pitched a tent there. And I think he did a place an altar there. And then now when God, when his faith is wavering, God shows up. And Abraham believed the Lord. And the Lord, because he believed the Lord, and the Lord counted him as righteous because of his faith. So the faith that saves is not faith in faith or how strong our faith is. The faith that saves is faith in the promise giver. Now, if I don't know about you, I have doubts. My faith journey is like this. Sometimes I'm strong faith. Sometimes I walk closely with God. At times, I feel God is so distant, and I feel that uncertain of God's promises. If I have to gain salvation based on my faith, I am doomed. But I thank God that that's not his requirement. His requirement is faith in the promise giver, trust in the promise giver, lean on the promise giver, believe in the promise giver. That's his only requirement. Let me go back. If you think about it, faith in obedience and faith in faith, so trust in faith, believe in faith, believe in obedience, they are all self-effort, right? And that's what God is saying here. I don't want you to be able to boast that you were able to earn your salvation, because it's whatever your righteousness doesn't match up to my standard. You are here, even lower, underground. Mine is up there. You don't match. I don't want you to be able to boast. If you want to boast, you can only boast in me. That's why this way of salvation, faith in the promise giver. Do we believe that? So this, the Jewish people back then, one of the biggest thing that they focus on is obedience to the law, right? They have Pharisees, Sadducees, spend their days making sure that they come up with rules so that they can fulfill the law and obey the law. And they came up with all these rituals and things to check on what type of sacrificial animal is acceptable to God. All those fine details, their faith and their baggage that they brought with them, these new believers, are one that's of obedience to the law exactly. Now, don't get me wrong. Obedience to God is a good thing. Having faith and strong faith is a good thing. But that's not what saves you. What saves you is faith in the promise giver alone. Obedience pleases God, but it doesn't save you. Obedience pleases God. So if we have faith in the promise giver, if we believe in this promise giver, we would delight in obeying him. Because why? We gain our salvation. It's a free gift from this promise giver. And we really want to worship him. And by obeying what he asks, what he says to us, that pleases him, that worship him. So I want us to remember the context. We're talking about salvation. Or not doesn't necessarily mean pleasing God. You know what? If our faith is in pleasing God to gain salvation, we are doomed again. So pleasing God, all these are good things. Obedience, all these are good things. And we should do that a lot. But that's not by us salvation. That's not what we can place our confidence in for our salvation. Okay, now Paul move on to the next thing that is also actually a really big baggage of the Jews. Their pedigree. What does that mean? Actually, Paul uses two things to hammer home this point. Circumcision and the law. What are the Jewish known for? They are the circumcised. Or they call it, they are the circumcision. They are the chosen people by God. And the way they were able to be affiliated with this chosen people is because they were given the law. They were asked to circumcise, and they do that. So Paul wanted to, again, unpack this baggage of them so that they can actually live in Christ in a more free way of any burden of the past. So it says this, is this blessedness only for the circumcised? The blessedness referring to is the salvation or the made righteous, okay? Or also for the uncircumcised? We have been saying that Abraham's faith was credited to him as righteousness. Under what circumstances was it credited? Was it after he was circumcised or before? It was not after, but before, and in fact, 14 years before. Chapter 15, verse 6, when God deemed him righteous, and when God asked him to circumcise, it was about 14 years. I think it's chapter 17, verse 6. Sorry, let me... Chapter 17, verse 23, roughly 14 years apart. So obviously, the answer is before. And the circumcision was received as a sign, a seal of the righteousness that he had by faith while he was still uncircumcised. So what come before? Is it the circumcision or is it the faith in the promise giver? Paul is saying, the circumcision is not even just the next day, but 14 years later. Obviously, what saved Abraham, what made Abraham righteous, was not the circumcision. So then, is he the father of all who believe, but have not been circumcised, in order that the righteousness might be credited to them? And he is then also the father of the circumcised, who not only are circumcised, but who also follow the footsteps of the faith that our father Abraham had before he was circumcised. So basically, Paul is saying, it's not the circumcision that saves you, but the faith in the promise giver. Okay? Then he brought out the law. It was not through the law that Abraham and his offspring received the promise that he would be heir of the world, but through the righteousness that comes by faith again. For if those who depend on the law are heirs, faith means nothing and the promise is worthless, because the law brings wrath. And where there is no law, there is no transgression. Therefore, the promise comes by faith, so that it may be by grace and may be guaranteed to all Abraham's offspring, not just, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who have the faith of Abraham. He is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made you a father of many nations. He is the father in the sight of God in whom he believed, the God who gives life to the dead and calls into beings that were not. So basically, Paul is saying that just because you grow up in an environment, a Jewish environment, and you think you are God's chosen people, that doesn't make you righteous. You still have, you can only call Abraham your father and God your father when you have the same kind of faith that saved Abraham. Faith in the promise giver. So, very simple, right? Faith in the religious rituals? Nah. Faith in religious activities? Nah. Faith in religious affiliation? Nah. How about us today? Do we subconsciously place our faith in church attendance, in baptism, in Lord's Supper? Hey, in Bible study. Do we subconsciously do that? I want you to get the context right again. I'm not saying these are things that we shouldn't be doing. I'm saying that these are things that doesn't gain us salvation. These are things that will help us, mature us, will help us please God, but it doesn't save us. Does the baptism come before faith or being made righteous? No. Will partaking in the Lord's Supper make you right with God? No. You know, if our faith is in church attendance, when I was attending college in the U.S., my freshman year, or my first year in university for the British system people, I went to the U.S. I have two roommates that were believers. They invited me to church one Sunday. I went with them. I have no recollection of what happened in the service at all. Nothing. And then they stopped inviting me ever again. They stopped talking about faith to me ever again. That was the first time and the last time I attended church in the U.S. And I was there 7 years. If faith is in church attendance and I went there once, I'm doomed. I'm sure I was the two young men that invited me was really heartbroken. They're saying, we invited this guy, but this guy just doesn't react. But what if these two guys is leaning on, if they continue to pray for me, maybe they did, I don't know, they continue to share their faith with me. They continue to talk about Christ with me, why they believe. They continue to share about this promise giver. Maybe, I don't know. Maybe I would accept Christ earlier. Let me retract that. I accepted Christ at the appropriate time that he predestined me to do that. So that was in Japan. But I'm just tossing out to make a point. If our faith is lean on church attendance, then all we have to do is when we met some unbelievers, hey, come to my church. Fettes Park has great sermon. When you listen to the pastor, you will get it and you will believe. If our faith is lean on that, it's not solid ground. But our faith is lean on the promise giver alone. Now, I'm again, all these things, I think it's very easy for us to say no, but sometimes subconsciously we do that. Like even I invited someone to church. Today, that person decided not to come. You know, God is teaching me an object lesson. You're preaching on this. Is your faith on the church service? I'm not saying the church service is bad. In fact, what Raymond and the worship team led us through this morning was fantastic. But that is not faith in the promise giver. That is not what is going to save you. So I'm good. I will continue to pray for this person that he will believe and in this promise giver. Okay? Now, this is the last part. Okay, looks like we're doing well on time. Paul now switched from misplaced faith to the type of faith that will save us. And you can tell my slides. Unwavering faith in the promise giver. It says this. Against all hope, Abraham in hope believed, and so became the father of many nations. Just as it had been said to him, so shall your offspring be. Against all hope. So meaning Abraham, based on his intellect, his human understanding, when God said, I'm going to make you a great nation, you have many descendants, and I have none. But he, in hope of having a son and having descendants that will be great nations, because he believed in and in hope for this, he became father of many nations. Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was so as good as dead. You know, when God said that he will have a son of his own, 14 years later, after he was asked to circumcise, he still doesn't have a son. That circumstances, he looked at himself, I am 99 years old, my wife, and my body is as good as dead. Sarah's womb, she had never pregnant before for so many years when she was in the what is that term called? Childbearing age. She never gave birth. Based on the circumstances, there's just no way this will come true. But it says without weakening and in his faith. Yet he did not waver through unbelief. I want to highlight this. He did not waver through unbelief. What does that tell us? He actually have unbelief, right? He actually at some point doesn't believe. But it says that yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith. Keyword, strengthened in his faith. He did not have strong faith to believe. When he has unbelief, he was strengthened in his faith. And because he was strengthened not by his own self-faith, it was strengthened by the promise giver, he gave glory to God. So when his faith is shaken, God shows up every time. the promise giver shows up every time. And the promise giver revealed more and more to him. And he believed more and more. And as he do that, he gave glory to God. And to the point where he's fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. This is why, and this is a key word, this is why it was credited to him as righteousness. So what kind of faith saves? This kind of faith. Unwavering faith in the promise giver. Not just unwavering faith. Because based on my experience, and I believe your own experience, we have doubt sometimes. Our faith may be shaken sometimes, and we may waver. But it's the unwavering faith in the promise giver that saves us. When our faith is on shaky grounds, expect God to meet us there. That is the kind of faith that will save us. The last few verses there, it's also us. It's also for us today how we are saved. It's not just Abraham. It's not just pre-Jesus people. It's also us today. The words it was credited to him were written not for him alone, not for Abraham alone, but also for us, to whom God will credit righteousness for us who believe in him, for us who have faith in him. In him that, what did he do? He raised Jesus, our Lord, from the dead. He was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. So Abraham was given this promise that he'll be father of great nations. He'll have descendants of the stars. We were given this promise that if we believe that there's only one way that we'll be made righteous, Jesus Christ, the gospel, right? Faith in the promise giver alone shall save us, nothing more. I want us to take a moment to look at this chart. I have to say to you, I Googled it. I copied the diagrams. I didn't draw it myself. It's easier. But it helps with the question. How confident are you with your righteousness before God? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I think most of us are like 2, 3, right? We will say, I'm confident most of the time. I'm confident some of the time. Some of us will say 1. I'm convinced and resting in confidence that no matter what I do, no matter what happened, I am 1. That is the position God wants us to be. Just like Abraham, as he journeyed through life, that's step by step having faith in the promise giver, and as there's unbelief or unwavering faith, when he's on shaky ground, he allowed God to speak to him and bring him back to the right spot, to a point where he's fully persuaded, right? Meaning he's fully confident. So Abraham is 1. So God wants us to be in this place today. He wants us to always say, I'm convinced and resting in confidence. You know what, the Jews view Abraham as their hero. Paul, we view as our hero. What did Paul say in two other letters? Philippians 1:6, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. So again, it's God that will help us have this confident, this unwavering faith in the promise giver, not us. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believe in God, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession to the praise of his glory. So I want us to celebrate today, because we have learned that faith misplaced will not save us, no matter how good the that thing is. Obedience, faith, circumcision, baptism, Lord's Supper, Bible study, church attendance. Those are all cell group, prayer meeting. Those are all good things, but those are not the thing that will save us. That's a good news, my friend, because we can't achieve that. People at Fettes Park can fail us. Hey, I'm sure I have failed you. I have wronged you at some point in time. If your faith is lean on me, being who you expect me to be, that is on shaky ground. Not just me, Jeremy, Alvin, the elders. If your faith is lean on the elders, the deacons, the Fettes Park, your cell group leaders, wrong place. It's faith in the promise giver. And unwavering faith. It's an active, continuous, living faith. Not just once upon a time, I have faith. But it's a continuous faith. And to have that continuous faith is not how strong our faith is, but it's how strong God is. So let us pray. Father Lord, I thank you this morning that you show us the kind of faith that will save us, the faith, unwavering faith in the promise giver. I also want to thank you that your promise of meeting us when our faith is shaky, so that our faith can grow to a point where we can say that we are fully confident, fully persuaded that what you say is true and we believe it. Father, I ask you to give us always this perspective, no matter what the circumstances are, that we'll believe and trust in you alone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Choon, for the wonderful message. You know, the book of James 2:23 tells us that Abraham believed in God and it was accounted to him as righteousness. And the book of James 2:23 added another statement. And he is called the friend of God. Yeah? This morning, another reassurance. If you believe in God, it's accounted to you as righteousness, and you are called a friend of God. All right? Joel believed in God, and he has accounted to him as righteousness, and he is called a friend of God. Right, Pastor Winnie? Friend of God? Amen. Choon, friend of God?
Yes.
Okay, are you a friend of God? All right, and he calls us friend, yeah? My question to you is today, do you consider him your friend? And we want to sing it today, yeah? What a friend we have in Jesus. Can you just stand up? What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. And what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. And oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Heavy trials and temptation. Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful? Find a friend so faithful, who will all our sorrows share. Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Lift it up. Are we weak and heavy laden?
Are we weak and heavy laden? Come with the Lord of care. Precious Savior, still our refuge.
Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Do thy friends despise.
Friends despise for safety. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
In His arm,
in His arms He'll take and shield.
Thou will find a solace there.
I will find a solace.
Let's sing, are we weak and heavy laden?
And are we weak and heavy laden?
Solace
there.
the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen. See you next week. Thank you.